making a film. Some other topics in the advanced macro economics. Then you have it there. It is ECM 404. My name is Dr. Muhammad Ali, and we are going to. There are certain general rules with which you must have been familiar with that guides the your conduct and the general rules about your examination and the marks being awarded. Today we are going to be looking at ECN 404. The earlier on we examined ECN 403, which is still Introduction to Advanced Macroeconomics 1. This semester it is Introduction to Advanced Macroeconomics 2. And then we are going to be looking at Introduction to Economic Growth and Development. At the end of this session, we are expected to be able to explain the concept of economic growth and development and make distinction between them. We also expected to be able to highlight the measurement, the various measurements of economic growth and development. We also expected to know how to explain the determinants of economic growth and development. So we move to the meaning of economic growth. According to Simon Kuznet, in his Nobel Memorial Lecture, he said economic growth, he sees economic growth as a long-term rise in the capacity of an economy to supply increasingly diverse economic goods to its population, with the growing capacity being based on advancement in technology and the institutional and ideological adjustment that it demands. Here, this definition looks at the concept of economic growth from three components. That is that sustained increase in the supply of goods. That secondly, it involves advancement in technology. And thirdly, that this advancement in technology must also be complemented by institutional and ideological changes. And all these, to Kuznet, is what constitutes economic growth. Why Anyao 1895 looks at economic growth as the increase over time of an economy's capacity to produce those goods and services needed to improve the well-being of the citizen in increasing numbers and diversity. It is imperative to examine behavior of population over time when economic growth is being discussed. Before a nation can experience, or an economy can experience growth that could be felt by the people, it is expected that the population growth rate should lag behind the rate of growth in the economy, meaning that the economic growth rate should be higher than the population growth rate. For example, in Nigeria, that is not what is obtainable in recent time. We have a situation where the population growth rate is a little bit more than the rate of growth in the economy. Thus, economic growth is a steady process of increasing the productive capacity of the economy, hence of increasing national income, being characterized by high rate of increase of per capita output and total factor productivity, especially labor productivity. So we have generally the goals of macroeconomics which you are familiar with. In developing countries, the goals that they usually set, their macroeconomic goals that are usually set are economic growth, price stability, full employment, and then healthy balance of payment position. Economic growth is, as generally being discussed these days, is seen as more of a problem of developed or advanced economies. But developing economies, their problem is not just economic growth, but that of economic development. This is because growth in developing economies has been found not to trickle down and have effect on the various strata of the economy. But in advanced economies, they already have development. They already have institutions that are well developed, and hence, whenever there is growth in those economies, it finds its way into affecting all the various aspects of the economies, even including the redistribution from the growth. But that is not the case in a developing economy. Then this calls for the need to distinguish between economic growth and economic development. Why economic growth development are inseparable concepts and often used interchangeably to mean the same. Occasionally, this usage is sometimes accepted, where the two terms exist, separating their meaning has merit. Growth refers to increase over time of an economy's output of goods and services. This definition does not take cognizance of desirable structural changes in the society's economic arrangement. Growth overlooks the distribution to and hence the well-being of the citizens of the economy. In contrast, the concept of economic development is more embracing, for it does not only concern itself with the issues of growth, but also focuses on the distribution of the proceeds from growth. Thus, economic development is generally defined to include improvement in material welfare, especially for persons with lowest income, the eradication of mass poverty with its correlates of illiteracy, disease and early death, changes in the composition of input and output that generally include shift in the underlying structure of production away from agriculture towards industrial activities. It is a multidimensional process involving the provision of basic needs, acceleration of economic growth, reduction of inequality and unemployment, eradication of absolute poverty, as well as changes in attitude, institutions, and structures of the economy. Then how can economic growth and development be measured? Look at the measurement of economic growth. Number one, there is nominal measurement of economic growth. Under this measurement, the concept of economic growth is seen as the increase in the current price values of aggregate products. It measures aggregate product only in terms of the current prices. Here, it is the prices that are ongoing that is used in measuring the aggregate productivity of the economy. But another measurement is real output growth rate as a measure of economic growth. Here, increase in aggregate output is looked in terms of constant prices. Here, the increase, having been measured, is deflated with a particular price index. So this represents real output growth. Then economic growth could also be measured in terms of growth in GNP per capita. This relates to an increase in the per capita real income of the economy. And per capita income is the overall growth divided by the measurement of GDP, that is the overall GDP of an economy divided by the population. So the rate of increase in the real per capita income should be higher than the rate of increase in the population. Then there is another measurement of growth which is looked at in terms of welfare. Economic development or growth can also be measured from the point of view of welfare. In this case, economic development is perceived to be an increase in the consumption of goods and services. How much of goods? How much of the choices that the people could be made of goods and services? And how much of these goods are being consumed? That is another measurement of economic growth and development. But some economists looked at the measurement in terms of social indicators. These social indicators could be categorized into six basic needs, which include health, education, good water supply, sanitation, and housing. So it is the availability of these social indicators that determine whether there is development. Then we look at the determinants of economic growth. We have economic and non-economic factors that could influence growth and development. The economic factors that influence growth and development. Generally, the rate of economy the growth rate of any economy depends on the changes of the factors of production, namely land, labor, capital, entrepreneurship. These constitute the economic factors that could influence growth. On land could be looked at. So we are going to look at the explanation of the various economic factors and the non-economic factors. On economic factors, as I earlier mentioned, start with land. Land could also mean natural resources. So natural resources in this sense is not just the land in the superficial sense, but it also includes the fertility of the land. In economic sense, the fertility of the land, the forest resources, minerals, climate, water resources, etc., constitute what is known as land or the natural resources. So for economic growth to take place, the existence of these resources is germane. In the LDCs, natural resources are unutilized, either unutilized or underutilized or misutilized. These natural resources are in abundance. For example, in Nigeria, there is a whole lot of natural resources in the country. Is it mineral resources? Is it the forest reserve? Is it the fertility of the land and good climate for agriculture? But however, these resources have not been optimally utilized in a manner that could bring about growth and development of the country. So it is not just the abundance of these resources. Growth requires optimal exploitation and utilization of these resources. So this is the reason why some economists have argued that economic growth is possible even when an economy is deficient in natural resources. Japan is one of such countries which is deficient in resources, but it is one of the advanced countries today because of its technology and how it has been able to discover uses of its limited resources. Another economic factor is labor or human resources. Human resources have been an important factor in modern economic development. Growth does not depend on the mere size of human resources, but on their efficiency. It is not your population that will determine your growth. It is not the how large is the population, but how efficient is the population. And one of the major ways that efficiency of the population could be enhanced is through education and training, and even investment in the health well-being of the people, ensuring that the people's health and educational needs are well taken care of. And this is why Zingier noted that the most important requirement of rapid industrial growth is people ready to welcome challenges of economic changes and opportunities. People above all who are dedicated to the economic development of their country and to high standard of honesty, competency, knowledge and performance. This also means that it's not just the educated people who have values, who have certain level of integrity and have nationalistic tendencies. The people who look at the interest of the country as more important than their own private interest. These constitute the quality and efficiency of the human resource, and of course, people who are very much healthy. Then another economic factor is that of capital accumulation. It is an important factor in growth. Capital represents the stock of resources which can be acquired through the stock of physical money. The increase on the capital stock over a period of time is capital accumulation. The process of capital accumulation includes the existence of savings and the rise of debt. This capital accumulation, one of the major determinants of capital accumulation is savings, that the people should be able to generate enough savings. The economy on itself should be able to generate enough savings, and because that savings will go into investment. Then another one is the existence of credit and financial institutions to mobilize savings and allocate them to desired sector. There should be a strong financial institution that will mobilize the savings, where the savings will go into, and that are going to be responsible in channeling the savings to from the areas where they are not much needed to areas where they are much in need of. So these constitute elements that aid capital accumulation. Another one is the use of these savings for investment. Now these savings shouldn't just be lying there, but they should be used for investment purposes. Then capital formation is the main key to economic growth, as it creates the opportunity for future production. Capital formation helps in providing machines, tools and equipment which are used in production process, because it is investment from the savings that will result in the acquisition of machines, equipment, raw materials and what have you that will be used in the production process, which will again lead to increase in productivity of the economy. And it is also that saving that could be channeled into technological development and even natural resources exploitation, which will at the end result in industrialization and expansion of market, which are essential for economic growth. In less developed countries or LDCs, the propensity to save is low. Hence, government often resort to forced saving by ways of taxation, deficit financing, and borrowing. The capacity to save, for example, in Nigeria is very low. And even this is why, particularly when you look at the savings from the informal sector, the government has not been able to ensure that the saving from the informal sector is well enhanced. And then It is because the savings are not too much. That is why the government has to look away from even the domestic economy. For example, we have a case where the deficit financing in the country has been growing, a case where external borrowing has been growing in the economy. This is because the capacity to save within the domestic economy is low. Another one economic factor that determines growth is entrepreneurship. This is another factor that influences economic growth. It relates to the optimum use of factors of production in economic activities. In modern economics, the entrepreneur performs the role of an organizer. He is an economic leader who possesses the capability and ability to recognize the opportunities for successful introduction of new commodities, new techniques, new sources of supply, and to assemble the necessary plant and equipment, management and labor force, and organize them into a running concern. Therefore, entrepreneurship is indispensable in economic development. However, LDCs lack entrepreneurial capability. Such constraints as the smallness of market, capital deficiency, technological backwardness, lack of skilled and trained labor, non-availability of adequate raw materials and infrastructure. Particularly this factor is an issue that is affecting entrepreneurship in less developed countries, the non-availability of infrastructure. And of course, this calls for the need for massive investment in infrastructure if LDCs must experience growth and development. The challenge, therefore, is for the LDCs to create a climate that will encourage entrepreneurship. And such climate has to do with availability of infrastructure, training, introduction of entrepreneurship, real entrepreneurship, and instilling the entrepreneurship mindset into the minds of the youth. This will bring about massive economic growth and development. Another economic factor is structural changes. This implies transition from the traditional agricultural-dominated economy to a modern industrial economy involving a radical transformation of existing institutional and social attitude and motivation. For example, in Nigeria, there is much contribution of the primary sector to the GDP. Nigeria depends too much or so much on the primary sector of the economy, where it just involves just mining resources, primary product, or tilling the land to acquire the for agricultural use. But that is not enough for the growth and development which the economy requires. There is a need to tilt the massive dependence on the primary sector to industrial sector dependence. It is this secondary sector that will lead into development, that should lead into the development of the tertiary sector. But what we have in Nigeria is a case where there is as if Nigeria has jumped a stage in its development from primary to tertiary. So there is massive tertiarization of the economy. This will not bring about any day growth because it is the primary sector and then the industrial sector, that is manufacturing, that can bring about the needed human capital engagement, to bring about the needed employment that will result in expansion of the economy and hence result in economic growth. Tertiary production includes a number of dissimilar services like transport, retail and wholesale distribution, education, government services and what have you. Then why the secondary production has to do with manufacturing. So structural changes from heavy dependence on the tertiary, on the primary sector to secondary and then the tertiary sector will enhance the growth of the economy. Then we have non-economic factors. As pointed out by Kane and Jingang 2003, development is not just a matter of having plenty of money, nor is it purely an economic phenomenon. It embraces all aspects of social behavior. The establishment of law and order, scrupulousness in business dealing, including dealings with the revenue authorities, relationship with the family, literacy, and familiarity with the mechanical gadget, and so on. All these constitute the non-economic factors that could bring about growth and development. And these are examined under two headings: social attitude. Attitude implies the totality of beliefs and values that cause human behavior to be what it is. Issues regarding social attitude, values, and institutions influence economic growth significantly. Western culture, for example, is one of the things that influence their growth and development. in Western world is critical reasoning. People do not reason in a dogmatic fashion. There is this inculcation of the spirit of entrepreneurship, spirit of discoveries and invention in the people. People have cultivated the habit of savings and investment and undertaking risks so as to earn profit. All these influence economic growth and development. Another non-economic factor is political and administrative factor. Political stability, protection and stability have encouraged the development of entrepreneurship, investment and industrialization in developed countries, along with the adoption of appropriate fiscal and monetary policy. With political stability, good governance. There are certain good governance indicators. Government where the institutions are working, where corruption is minimal, then where there is peace and stability in the economy, all this, where there is no crisis of ethnicity, religion, and what have you. These are necessary non-economic ingredients that can bring about growth and development. Thus, the government of LDCs must step up effort to offer services required for economic development, such as order, justice, security, reward system, etc. In this way, clean and strong administration of full justice can stimulate economic development. Because it is even this force, existence of this element of political and administrative factors that can even influence the inflow of investment and can even also influence domestic investment in the economy, which will at the end result in stimulation of economic growth and development. We have been able to examine the concept of economic growth and development, also been able to make distinction between economic growth and development. We've also been able to highlight the measurement of economic growth and development. And then we have explained the economic and non-economic determinant of economic growth and development. In our next class, we shall be considering the theories of economic growth and